Lamentations chapter 1. Remember where Lamentations is? It's right in the book of Jeremiah. I remember that so easily because it proves about a lady in the mission field who named her little boy Jeremiah Lamentations. Lamentations chapter 1 and verse 12. Is it nothing to you, all ye that pass by? Behold and see if there be any sorrow like unto my sorrow which is done unto me, wherewith the Lord hath afflicted me in the day of his fierce anger. And then in chapter 3 and verse 31, he says, for the Lord will not cast off forever. The Lord will not cast off forever. But though he cause grief, yet will he have compassion according to the multitude of his mercies. For he doth not afflict willingly, nor grieve the children of men. 20-year-old Tristan was simply taking a motorcycle ride on what appeared to be a beautiful spring afternoon. Earlier that morning, his aged grandfather had stopped by the farm that Tristan and his mother ran. Grandfather had quit driving quite a while back, and so it was quite a surprise to see him pull up in his old truck. But he was here as if some strange providence had sent him. Tristan had sent a text to his mother the day before, telling her how much he loved life and how much he appreciated her and all that she did for him. But less than 48 hours ago, a young driver whose license had already been revoked for DUI pulled out into the road without stopping, without looking, and he collided with Tristan and his mother. Tristan's family was in shock, especially his mother, who had been driving in a car behind him and saw the accident happen. But she was of hope, somehow, that he could be okay. But Tristan was losing massive amounts of blood. After an emergency surgery to simply try to stabilize him by packing his body full of gauze, he was sent to CT. And the vigil outside the intensive care unit began. Tristan's father, the leading neurosurgeon at the trauma center, had to entrust his son's life into the hands of others that night. The evening turned into night, and night turned into morning. And early at 6 o'clock a.m., yesterday morning, a surgeon came out and said, we have to make some decisions. Gallons of blood had been transfused into Tristan in an attempt to keep him alive, despite tests showing that he had no brainstem activity. As the terrible decision was made, his mother asked me, you see, I had become the default pastor, family counselor, and friend to dozens of Tristan's friends that night. His mother asked me, Mary, she said, are you tired? Are you tired? Of course, I told her. We were all tired. We'd been up all night. But God's grace was sufficient. But then she said, no. I mean, are you tired of this world and suffering? And to that I replied that I was indeed very tired of the suffering, the trauma that it causes us. And today I ask you, are you tired? Are you tired today, not just simply physically tired, but are you tired of this world of sin that we live in? Of reading obituaries in the paper from young people such as Tristan, of seeing suffering in Haiti from massive earthquake, from the cyclones and the tsunamis who hit Bangladesh and other countries. I hope that we are all tired. The suffering that is part of humanity. And I assure you, friends, that because the Bible says that we were made in the image of God, we were made with emotions, and God has emotions too. And God understands our emotions. He understands what it is like to hurt. The stress and the experiences such as Tristan's give rise to our inner distresses. We are tempted to feel a sense of injustice. We are frustrated with great loss. We may even be tempted to feel angry. Anger that God has allowed this to happen. Or angry that we were not able to be helpful to somehow prevent it or fix it. But I want to tell you today, friends, that Jesus Christ Himself provides an example of such suffering to us, and how we may live over and above the suffering. But I want to first begin by looking at some of the causes of our emotional stress and suffering. And there are many. And last night, as I was codifying these things that I had been thinking about for the last 40 hours together, maybe 24 or so at that time, I ended up with a long list. And we can't go through that long list today. We had to go through the short list. So this is by no means complete. But like I said, I think that one of the first things that causes us this emotional suffering at times, especially like this, is a sense of the injustice, the seemingly injustice of it all. The wicked seem to live in indifference to God's law and to man's laws. How dare a boy, a 16-year-old boy, drive so careless as to not look even before he pulls out? How dare he even get into an automobile after his license had already been revoked for DUI? David related to this. If you would turn with me to the 119th Psalm. Psalms 119 and verse 53. He says, "Horror hath taken hold upon me because of the wicked that forsake thy law." David saw this. He saw how the wicked lived as if with impunity, and it brought horror to him. In Psalms 82 and verse 2. Psalms 82 and verse 2. It says, "How long will ye judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked?" How long will this continue? As I was sitting beside Tristan's mother, she looked at me and she said, "I don't want to be Job. I don't want to be a Job tonight," making reference to the fact that her firstborn, Christina, was killed 12 years earlier in a car accident. Job not only had personal tragedy with the death of his 10 children, but Job also saw the wicked not come under justice. In Job 19 and verse 7 also, it says, "Behold, I cry out of wrong, but I am not heard. I cry aloud, but there is no judgment." The seeming injustice of life. People who say bad things about us, who turn our families against us. People who treat us wrongly. And we say, "It's not fair." And of course, it's not fair. But sometimes we fail to remember that sin is not fair. That Satan plays by no rules. And life can be terribly hard because the only bed of roses many times we have, friends, are the thorns. We feel these inner emotions and this stress because of our frustrations. Our frustration with not being able to see and understand God's workings. After Tristan came out of his first surgery, his mother said, "I know God's going to help him. I know we can count on God." But after the machines were turned off, she said, "I don't understand. Why is God doing this? Why does God allow this? And we become frustrated not being able to see and understand God's workings. And friends, we're not alone. This is universal. In Job chapter 23, verse 8 and 9, he says, "Behold, I go forward, but he is not there, and backward, but I cannot perceive him. On the left hand, where he doth work, but I cannot behold him. He hideth himself on the right hand, that I cannot see him. But he knoweth the way that I take. When he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold." Job says, "I can't see God, I don't understand God, I can't feel God." But something Job had, and we'll talk more about later, was Job had faith. He had faith to see the unseen. He had faith to see the invisible God that no man has seen at any time. But we are tempted because of our frustrations to wonder where God is. And we're frustrated at times that he just doesn't stop Satan. Why did he allow that young boy to get in his car? Why didn't he send an angel to put a brake on that car or to somehow just slow it down by a half of a second? In 1 Thessalonians in the New Testament, in chapter 2, in verse 18, Paul says, "Wherefore we once would have come unto you," writing to these people at Thessalonica. He says, "Even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us." Well, I wonder what those people thought. Well, why did God allow that, Paul? You're Paul. He shouldn't have hindered you. And you know, we think about ourselves and we think about how maybe good we are or how much we've done for God or all the little things we've done to get credit, you know, on our little ledger. Why does God allow Satan to have ways with us? Maybe to allow someone to assault us. Or to cast us down, as it were. We feel these frustrations when we suffer loss, when we lose things. I saw a headline in the news yesterday. I don't know anything about this man, but his name is D. Gordon. He plays for the Florida Marlins professional baseball team. And he had a drug test which proved that he had been taking sports or physical enhancing drugs, steroids, anabolic steroids. And so he's been suspended for almost half of the baseball season. He's going to lose about $5 million in salary because of this. And you know what he said? "I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry." He was sorry. He had these emotions of sufferings because of a temporal loss. But friends, what if we lose our spiritual birthright? Think about Esau. Remember Esau and the birthright? And how he was just so sad about this? But he didn't really appreciate the birthright because of the spiritual blessings. He simply wanted those temporal blessings of the birthright. In fact, if we turn to Genesis 27, we should read it in verse 34. "And when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with a great and exceeding bitter cry, and said unto his father, Bless me, even me also, my father. And in verse 38, and Esau said unto his father, Hast thou but one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, O my father. And Esau lifted up his voice and wept." He was weeping because of his loss. But it wasn't because he could have been the progenitor of the Messiah that he wept. He was thinking about that double portion he should have got. He was thinking about being ruler of the clan and those things. We suffer loss today through the death of our loved ones in bereavement. And that loss doesn't go away quickly and easily. Tristan's mother told me, she says, "I can't do this." And those were the exact words that I had said to myself 9 years before. "I can't do this. I can't bury a second child." During World War II, following a battle, word was carried back that an only son had been killed in action. and a minister went to the home of the grief-stricken parents to try to help them. The father was pacing the floor. He was weeping. He was feeling these emotions. He was angry. And he demanded of the minister, "Where was God when my son was being killed?" And the silence prevailed, and then the minister simply replied, "I guess where he was when his son was being killed." And this calm, this profound answer, it impacted the father, for it brought God out of the remoteness into the circle of real life. And we need to understand, friends, when we suffer, we don't suffer alone. We may not, as Job said, feel God. We may not find Him. We may not see Him. We may not touch Him. But I assure you, He is there through the worst of our trials and our problems. Jacob knew what it was like to lose a child, even though he didn't really lose that child. He thought he had lost his son. And oh, how he wept. In Genesis 37. You know, the brothers had sold Joseph off. And perhaps except for Reuben, they might have killed him. And they took his coat of many colors, and they had torn, and they had the blood of an animal to make it look like Joseph had been killed and eaten by a wild animal, and they brought him to Jacob. And boy, you know, their satisfaction went away pretty quickly when they saw their father's grief. The grief that that man had, it just broke him down. And Jacob rent his clothes and put sackcloth upon his loins and mourned for his son many days. And all his sons and all his daughters rose up to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. And he said, "I will go down into the grave unto my son mourning." Thus his father wept for him. And except that he had been reunited with Joseph years later, he would have went to his grave mourning and weeping for his son. David even suffered greatly in the loss of a rebellious son, who, if their places had been reversed or traded around, his son would have killed him without blinking an eye. And yet David cried and said, "Oh, Absalom, Absalom, my son, I would have God died for thee." 2 Samuel 18:33. And then in Matthew 2:16-18. Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth, and sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coast thereof, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying, "In Ramah there was a voice heard, lamentation and weeping for her children, and would not be comforted because they are not." Till you have lost a child, that is hard to understand. But even worse than bearing or a young son who's a Christian, the thought, to me it is the thought of the spiritual death of perhaps our children or our loved ones. Our children may be living physically fine, but yet they're dead, and they don't know it. They are dead spiritually, and this should cause even more grief to a spiritual parent. You know, as we as Christians, as we look at the way Jesus lived, and we are to live how? As He lived. We find, friends, that we are not going to be immune from suffering and grief. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen at all. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 20 and verse 28. Jesus said, "Even as the Son of Man not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many." Jesus didn't come to have an easy time. He came to minister, and he knew that in doing this, he was going to bring upon himself suffering and much suffering. Jesus certainly knew what it was to suffer as he ministered to others. In Isaiah chapter 53, Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 3. Speaking of Jesus, it says that He is despised and rejected of men. A man of what? Oh, you don't think the Lord ever sorrowed? You don't think the Lord ever had emotional grief within Himself? It says He was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from Him. He was despised and we esteemed Him not. Do you know, when you feel sorrow, when you are grieving, you know what you need more than anyone else? Anything else? We need people. We need this comfort from others. You know, this is why when these kind of terrible things happen, you see these people and they're hugging each other and just holding on to each other. I was sitting in the ICU lobby, just a couple of chairs down from Tristan's dad. And he had to go back to talk to the surgeons and make this decision. And while he was there, one of the nurses came through who had been one of Ann's nurses the week before. And she recognized me, and she had seen me earlier, and we had discussed what was happening. And she just came over. And she didn't ask permission. But she just came over and sat down beside me, and she just grabbed my hand with a vice grip and just held on to it. She bowed her head and started to pray. And then she came up and she held my hand. She says, "Is there any new news?" You know, she just needed to have someone to associate with in this grief. And what does it say that we did with Christ? It says we hid, as it were, our faces from Him. His grief became much worse because of us. And in Gethsemane, He felt alone. Even the disciples couldn't watch with Him. Even His three most trusted disciples couldn't watch with Him. And even the Father was beginning to withdraw His presence from Him at that time. But we as Christians, we as workers for Christ, and we are all called to be ministers for Christ in some fashion or another, we should not feel that we are going to be immune from sufferings, especially sufferings that are involved in our work for the Master. Notice in 2 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul speaks of this, and we could read through several verses here where, in 2 Corinthians 11, where he talks about the physical abuses that he went through for Jesus, and you know he had to suffer for those things. But he comes down to verse 28 and 29, and after discussing about being whipped and beaten and shipwrecked and all these things, he says, "Beside those things which are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. Who is weak, and I am not weak? Who is offended, and I burn not?" Paul said, look, these things, they affect me too. They affect me too. I heard the story about a man who had a dream. It's supposed to be a true story, and I may modify it slightly, but he dreamed that he went to the celestial city. Though when he got there and how he got there, he couldn't tell. He said, "I saw a great number which no man could number, from all nations and peoples and tongues and times and ages. And somehow he found himself next to a saint who had lived during the time of Nero. 'Who are you?' I said to him." He said, "We both spoke the same language of heavenly Canaan, so I understood him and he understood me. 'I,' he said, 'was a Roman Christian. I lived in the days of the Apostle Paul. I was one of those who died in Nero's persecutions. I was covered with pitch and fastened to a stake and set on fire to light up Nero's gardens.' 'How awful,' I exclaimed. 'No,' he said, 'I was glad to do something for Jesus. He died on the cross for me.' And then a man from another side spoke who had lived during the 19th century. And he said, 'I came from an island in the South Seas, Eromanga. John Williams, a missionary, came and told me about Jesus, and I too learned to love him. My fellow countrymen killed and ate the missionary, and they caught and bound me. I was beaten until I fainted, and then they thought I was dead, but I revived. The next day they knocked me on the head, cooked, and ate me.' 'How terrible,' I said. 'No, I was glad to die as a Christian. You see, the missionaries had told me that Jesus was scourged and crowned with thorns for me.' Then they both turned to me and said, 'What did you suffer for him?' Or did you sell what you had for the money which sent men like John Williams to tell the heathen about Jesus? And the man who had the dream said in his dream that he was speechless. And while they were both looking at me with sorrowful eyes, I awoke, and it was a dream. But I lay on my soft bed awake for hours, thinking of the money I had wasted on my own pleasures, or my extra clothing, or costly car, and many luxuries, and I realized that I did not know what the words of Jesus meant in Mark chapter 8 and verse 34. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. The Apostle Paul did understand suffering. In Romans chapter 9, verses 1 through 4, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Spirit. Paul here in his beginning verse lists three different ways that he's going to tell you that he is telling you the truth. And you should listen to what he's going to say because it's profound and it's important. And he says, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart, for I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh, who are Israelites, to whom pertaineth the adoption and the glory and the covenants and the giving of the law and the service of God and the promises. Paul says, if I could save those people who are my kinsmen by being accursed, I would do that for them. I love them and I'm heavy at heart for them. There's a statement in Ministry of Healing on page 253. It says this, when someone asks how you are feeling, do not try to think of something mournful to tell in order to gain sympathy. Do not talk of your lack of faith and your sorrows and your sufferings. She goes on to say, the tempter delights to hear such words. When talking on gloomy subjects, you are glorifying him. You are not to dwell on the great power of Satan to overcome us. Often we give ourselves into his hands by talking of his power. Let us talk instead of the great power of God to bind up all our interests with his own. Tell of the matchless power of Christ and speak of his glory. All heaven is interested in our salvation. The angels of God, thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000, are commissioned to minister to those who shall be heirs of salvation. They guard us against evil and press back the powers of darkness that are seeking our destruction. And so, friends, we're going to have sufferings. We're going to have these things happen. But you know what? We look forward. We look above. We look higher than these things. Because God responds, friends, to our emotional sufferings. He understands these things. He knows about them. And he's not unmindful of them. And he comes to help us to go through these things. He gives us comfort. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, on in verse 3, he says, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies, and the God of all, what? Comfort. He is the God of all, what? Comfort. Who comforteth us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. You mean, preacher, that God sometimes allows us to go through trials to be comforted so that we know how to be comforted and then we can take and share that comfort with others? That's what Paul says. Yes. Paul says, sometimes I allow you. You know, it's interesting, I talked to Tristan's mother a couple times and I mentioned something to her at one point about losing two children. And then I'd moved around and was just trying to talk to some other young people, and then just was sitting alone for a little while. And one of Tristan's mother's good friends that was with her about all the time, she came over to me and she said, did you say earlier that you'd lost two children? I said, yes, I did. She says, will you go over and sit with her again? She needs to hear that. And she says, do you still have any children? I said, yes, I still have a daughter. She says, she needs to hear that and that life can go on, because Tristan still had a younger sister, Rachel, 7 years old. And so the comfort that God had helped me to understand in losing two children, somehow I could help share that comfort with a mother who was on the verge of losing her second child. He says, who comforteth us in all our tribulation. He doesn't say that he comforts us from our tribulations, but are in our tribulations. And God has ways of comforting us and ways of helping us. And one of the beautiful ways that he has ordained to help us is that he sends angels to be near us at times like these. In the book Acts of the Apostles, On page 153, we are told this: heaven is brought near to earth by that mystic ladder, the base of which is firmly planted on the earth, while the topmost round reaches the throne of the infinite. Angels are constantly ascending and descending this ladder of shining brightness, bearing the prayers of the needy and distressed to the Father above, and bringing blessing and hope, courage and help to the children of men. These angels of light create a heavenly atmosphere about the soul, lifting us toward the unseen and the eternal. We cannot behold the forms with our natural sight. Only by spiritual vision can we discern heavenly things. The spiritual ear alone can hear the harmony of heavenly voices. And it was like Job. He says, if I go to my left hand, I can't find him. If I look to the right hand, he's not there. He says, but I know that he's there. He knew by faith. And he had that spiritual vision. He had that spiritual audio acuity to hear the heavenly restraints. You know what it says in Psalms 34 and verse 7? The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him and delivereth them. God sends angels, friends, to help us in these times. And he sends deliverance to us through Jesus Christ. In Isaiah 53, we read verse 3 earlier, but let's read verse 4 now. It says, surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Even while we rebelled against him, he carried our sorrows. He bore our griefs for us. And he gives us the privilege of entering into that suffering. Say, I don't want to enter into that suffering. Well, I want to read this statement to you. Maybe it will help you. The Ministry of Healing on page 478. Of all the gifts that heaven can bestow upon man, fellowship with Christ. Oh, that's a great gift, isn't it? But that's not where it stops. It says, fellowship with Christ in his sufferings is the most weighty trust and the highest honor. To have fellowship with Christ in his sufferings is the greatest trust and honor that heaven bestows upon man. She continues, she says, not Enoch, who was translated to heaven, not Elijah, who ascended in a chariot of fire, was greater or more honored than John the Baptist, who perished alone in the dungeon. Unto you it is given in behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. Philippians 1:29. And may I remind you that in 2 Peter 1:4, he tells us that it is by being a partaker of these exceeding great and precious promises that we become a partaker of the divine nature. And this text, like we have here in Philippians 1:29, is it an exceeding great and precious promise to us? Mm-hmm. It surely is to us today. Because you see, friends, Jesus has promised to help us through our trials, our struggles, or whatever it may be. He's offered to give us rest. Let's just notice a few texts. Let's turn first to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. In verse 1, Jesus gives us actually a command. He says, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. And God's biddings are his what? Enablings. Christ Object Lessons 333. And so he says, let not your heart be troubled. That means our hearts don't have to be troubled, friends. In the same chapter, in verse 27, he says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be, what? Troubled. Neither let it be afraid. Jesus has invited all of his people. He says, come unto me, Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls. Jesus promises to give us rest at these troublous times in our lives, even right now. And he's promised to give us eternal rest in heaven. In Revelation chapter 21, in verse 4, he says, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. No pain, friends, of any kind. And so, as believers, how do we respond then? Knowing that God has sent Christ to help us, knowing that He is the God of comfort, how do we respond to these things? Well, I think, first of all, I think we have to be honest and assess the problem before God. I'd like for you to notice in Psalms 73. Remember, we were talking earlier about the seeming injustice. The injustice of things that happen, and we don't understand why God allows things to happen, or why God seemingly even afflicts us at times. And David had similar concerns. But it says, truly God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. But he says, but as for me, my feet were almost gone, my steps had well nigh slipped. For I was envious at the foolish when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. And he goes on to explain about how the wicked seemed to continue in their wickedness, and there was no impunity. They could just seemingly do what they wanted to do. And it caused him great suffering. But then he says in verse 16, when I thought to know this, it was too painful for me. Verse 17, until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I their end. There he saw the fat burning upon the altar, the fat symbolic of sin, and knew that the final end was going to be destruction for all sin and those who would cling to it. In Psalms 119, you know, and because we know that, friends, because we know that, when people cause us grief or hurt us, we don't have to try to retaliate as Christians. Because God says, vengeance is mine, I will repay. Vengeance isn't ours, vengeance is His. Because it's against Him that they sin, it's not against us. In Psalms 119, in verse 78, it says, let the proud be ashamed, for they dealt perversely with me without a cause, but I will meditate in thy precepts. You see how we respond? People abuse us. They may assault us. But what do we do instead? God, they're yours. I'm going to meditate upon your precepts. We have to trust in Him. You know, sometimes people take Romans 8:28 and they say, you know, everything works, everything that happens is good. Because the Bible says, for all things work together for good to them who love the Lord and are called according to His purpose, Romans 8:28. But the text doesn't say that everything that happens is good. But it does say that everything that happens, something good can come out of it. There are terribly bad things that happen. But God is so magnificently great and magnificently wise, exceedingly wise, that He can even take the worst of things that Satan can throw at us, and He can send it back as a blessing. Have you ever seen that thing that's a piece of wood sort of shaped like a U or an L that they have from Australia? They call it a boomerang. You know what a boomerang is? And you throw it one way, but if it's thrown properly, it returns to you if it doesn't hit something. And so God, He sort of works like a boomerang, you know, the boomerang method. Satan throws something at us, but God takes it and He sends it back. And He makes something good from it for us. In Psalm 62, in verse 8, Psalm 62, in verse 8, it says, trust in Him at all times, ye people. Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us. When my child is laying on the operating table alive and he makes it, and I say, God's going to help us. And then when the machines are shut down, all of a sudden I say, where was God? He let me down. Or I say something like, I don't understand this. Why would He do this to me? You know, it's okay to question things because we don't always know. But it's not okay to fail to trust Him. It's true, we may not know. And we can say that at times. But we should also say, but I know that my Redeemer liveth, and the latter day that He shall stand upon the earth, and I will stand there with Him. God hasn't decided to tell us everything. We don't have to know everything. But when these times come, these times of distress, it is a call for us to enter into prayer. I know I was talking with Kevin yesterday, and he was really concerned about his mom. He said, I want you to know, he said, I got on my knees, and I prayed for 15 minutes about that situation. You know, bless his heart. And that's what these things sometimes are designed to do, is to drive us to prayer. And Jesus, our example in all things, did this himself in Hebrews chapter 5, verses 6 and 7. And he saith also in another place, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Of course, we know this speaking about Jesus then. It says, verse 7, who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he feared. Jesus had strong crying and tears. He was a man of emotions. And he took those emotions to his Father, and God answered him. And we could look at many other examples. Abraham, when he learned about the destruction of Sodom, he pled with God for the lives of Lot and his family and those who might be with them. During the rebellion of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, Moses interceded in behalf of Israel, that one man might not cause the destruction of the whole camp. We noted the prayer, one of the prayers of David earlier. The distress of Jonah being in the belly of the great fish. The Bible says that he prayed. He prayed. And there's a text in James, why we're here in Hebrews. We can turn over to James chapter 5 and verse 13. It says, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Now, this affliction it's speaking about is not speaking of a physical affliction. It's not talking about sickness. He covers that in verse 14. But the word afflicted here in the Greek is kakopatheo. And it means to experience something which comes from without and which has to be suffered. Something that comes from without that causes an internal suffering in amongst us. It means to endure hardship, to suffer distress. Again, it's not physical sickness, but this is simply one of those emotional, spiritual darts that Satan sends to us, perhaps directly or through a family member or through an incident or through an experience. And it says that when we have these things come, the solution is to pray. To pray. And we are not to give up, but we are to continue then doing what we know is right. So we look to God for comfort, we seek Him for help, we look for help through Jesus, we pray, and then we continue on, friends. We don't stop. In Job chapter 1, verse 20, Job arose and rent his mantle and shaved his head and fell down upon the ground and worshipped and said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. Paul, who spoke of his experiences, and one who could speak from experience and not from a far-off position, noted these words in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 1. He says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy the vocation wherewith ye are called. Paul told them to continue to walk worthy because he knew what it was like to continue in walking worthy. And in Philippians 1:27, he says, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, no matter what our conversation is. This is the cocoon of the emperor moth. It's sort of flask-shaped. And in order for this perfect insect to appear, it must force its way through the neck of the cocoon in hours of intense struggle. It is believed by scientists who study this that the pressure to which the moth's body is subjected is a provision of God for forcing the juices into the veins of the wings. And this is what it looks like after it comes out, or at least one of the variations of it. But there was a person one time who was witnessing the struggle. And out of pity, he took the point of some scissors and he snipped the confining threads to make the exit easier. But the moth's wings never developed. And it spent its brief lifespan crawling instead of flying through the air on the rainbow of wings. We should look not with false pity on God's children who suffer. As men, as women, as part of our humanity, we are inclined to be short-sighted. God would have us inspire their courage in the midst of it by remembering His love and then looking for the glory, the greater glory that will come out of the struggle. We are told in the book Desire of Ages, upon the altar of sacrifice. He, that is Abraham, laid his son of promise, the son in whom his hopes were centered. Then as he waited beside the altar with knife upraised to obey God, he heard a voice from heaven saying, "Lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing that thou hast not withheld thy son, thine only son from me." Genesis 22:12. The terrible ordeal was imposed upon Abram that he might see the day of Christ and realize the great love of God for the world, so great that to raise it from its degradation, he gave his only begotten son to a most shameful death. Abraham learned of God the greatest lesson ever given to mortals. His prayer that he might see Christ before he should die was answered. He saw Christ. He saw all that mortal can see and live. By making an entire surrender, he was able to understand the vision of Christ which had been given him. He was shown that in giving his only begotten Son to save sinners from eternal ruin, God was making a greater and more wonderful sacrifice than ever man could make. And it was through the sufferings of that experience that Abraham saw Christ. He saw him in a way he would never see him otherwise. And you know, I can honestly tell you that after the death of Hans, I could see that too in a way I had never seen it before. But here we have this great example for us. This example of emotional suffering, because Abraham didn't suffer just for a moment, you know. This was a process of about 3 days that Abraham went through this. And so God has given us, friends, sufferings. It's true they build our character, but they bring us closer to God. And as we learn to suffer and learn to receive comfort from God, we can help others who are sorrowful, others who need comfort. And when those times of trouble come to us, we look to God for our comfort, friends. We pray to Him, and we continue forward. We never look back. The Bible tells us about one woman who looked back. And in Luke chapter 17, verse 32, Jesus very cryptically just simply said, "Remember Lot's wife." Because when we look back, friends, we can't go forward, we won't go forward, we won't go to heaven. But we can have eternity with our Lord. We can be a part of that group that knows no more pain, no more suffering ever again. But it's not going to happen without some suffering on this earth. But by God's grace, friends, we can go through it. And you can go through it. And you can do this.
That's right.
By God's grace and by His grace alone. And I want to call upon you. I want to encourage you today that in this coming week, and I would be, I don't think, amiss to predict. And I'm not the prophet or the son of the prophet, but I think I would not be amiss to predict that someone who's hearing my voice now, and maybe many of you, will have some kind of grief, some kind of suffering of some kind that's going to happen. It may be physical stress, it may be an emotional stress, it could be the loss of a loved one, it could be because of the frustration not being able to help, it could be because of the seemingly injustice that happens. Doesn't matter. God is there, and He's there to help every time.
That's right.